G'day everybody and welcome to another attempt at me making a midweek video.
Amis français, cette vidéo ne sera pas traduite pour des questions techniques et de temps.
Désolé.
Désolé, mais on vous aime quand même.
Today I want to talk about overlanding vehicles and setups. Now from the title you're probably going to think I'm going to make some sort of wild claim that we have the perfect overland vehicle. Well you're right, but let me explain why. When I say the perfect overland rig, I say that on a completely personal opinion related to our goals, situation, and needs. Now, I'm gonna completely contradict myself and say there is absolutely no such thing as the perfect overland rig. Every person, couple, or family will have their own specific requirements in their dream overland build. So from this video, we're not preaching that we have the perfect setup and that it will suit you. We just hope that from this video, you can maybe take away some ideas or get a little bit of advice to help you build your dream vehicle if that's what your plan is. Now, I think it's absolutely impossible for a manufacturer to market a design and claim that that design is gonna suit everybody's specific needs and requirements in one package. Now, I'm gonna be absolutely honest with you guys and explain why I think that our rig is the perfect setup to suit us in our overland journey around the world. Quickly, a little bit of background on the both of us and our experience. Now, I've been driving 4x4s or off-road vehicles now since I had my license. We get it at 17 years old. My first vehicle was a 4x4, a Holden Jackaroo. This car was a great little car, made a lot of mistakes in that car, learned a lot in that car. Together, myself and Stephanie did our time in a rooftop tent. We traveled around Australia towing a camping trailer for 2 years. We towed this camping trailer with a Toyota Land Cruiser 80 series. This was a very good car. The trailer itself had a lot of sentimental value. It was passed down through my family, belonged to my uncle 40 years ago. It did a couple of laps of Australia with him and his family. The trailer was used with my family for my entire childhood away on regular camping trips. Then my father gave the camping trailer to myself and Steph. We stripped it back and completely rebuilt it to suit us, and we used that to travel around Australia for the 2 years living in the rooftop tent. 6 years ago, Steph and I left Australia to travel Europe, and I finally found myself in a position to buy my dream childhood vehicle, a Land Rover Defender. We bought a 2004 TD5 Land Rover Defender 90. We used this vehicle to travel all around Europe, Eastern Europe, as far as Turkey on an extended rock climbing trip over 2 years. After completing this trip in the 90, we made a commitment, and that commitment was to continue this overland lifestyle full-time for the long term. We also decided that for the long term, we wouldn't mind a little bit of extra space and a little bit of comfort, a bit more storage room. So we bought our first Land Rover Defender 130 and a four-wheel camper Grizzly model. Unfortunately, we lost bear number one in a major accident in Portugal. Fortunately, nobody was hurt. Secondly, the camper Grizzly wasn't on the truck at the time. After a long and stressful battle with a French insurance company, we bought our second Land Rover Defender, a 2010 2.4 model. Bear number two. Back to the point, why is our setup perfect for us? Firstly, and probably one of the hot topics, why Land Rover Defender? Us, along with our fellow Defender owners, cop a lot of flack when it comes to our vehicle choice. Well, I can tell you right now, I would not change it for the world. Defenders and Land Rovers in general come with a proven and reliable history dating back 60 years. But it's not only that. It's the sense of community, almost family, that comes with owning a Land Rover that I really do not think you can experience owning any other vehicle. But again, that's my personal opinion. All right, so I did say Land Rover and reliable in the same sentence. If you've followed us for a while, you'll see we have had our fair share of issues. When you choose to overland the world, tackling some of the worst trails in very, very remote locations, I don't care how good your preventative maintenance regime is, things are going to go wrong. It's inevitable. You can only do your best to minimize what goes wrong. For us, we see that that as part of the life that we have chosen. When things go wrong, it's how you recover from this that is the challenge and the real test. At the end of the day, the choice of vehicle is an absolutely personal decision. When we're asked for advice on what vehicle to take, I'll tell people go with any vehicle you want. The vehicle is not important, it's the journey that matters. Overlanding is completely possible in any form, from walking, cycling, 4x4s, expedition trucks, even a Vespa around the world, like our good mate Ilario. So now I'm going to explain why we chose Grizzly and Bear to overland the world, just bearing in mind, please, that this is our personal opinion. For us, the priority in choosing our setup was to have our living space and our vehicle as two separate items. In fact, this was essential. Firstly, as you guys probably know, we are passionate rock climbers. Now, we'll often arrive in a climbing area and choose to stay in that climbing area for weeks at a time. Having the option to remove the house from the truck, leave that in a secure campsite somewhere, and then have our vehicle available to go on daily expeditions to the climbing areas without having to pack up our setup every single time we want to drive the vehicle is absolutely awesome. Another benefit is the ability to tackle more challenging 4x4 trails. Afghanistan was a perfect example of this. We knew the trail was going to be very challenging. We knew it was remote with very limited, almost no support, you know, if we needed recovery. We made the decision to leave the camper behind in Tajikistan and take only the truck, and we can push it just that little bit further and maybe take trails that we wouldn't quite be prepared to take if we had our house on the back. Being able to remove the camper during times of vehicle maintenance has also been invaluable over the years. The Defender alone is much easier lifted on a garage's vehicle hoist than when the camper's attached. Another benefit is if the car requires some serious maintenance, then we can live inside the camper at the front of a garage or put it up in a parking somewhere while the car can stay inside the workshop and be moved around and worked on. All right, so I've explained a couple of reasons why we went for a truck camper in particular. Now I'll be more specific and say why four-wheel camper. Now I've got a good mate, Jai, to thank for this. Cheers, Jai, for introducing me to the wonderful world of truck campers. Now, I left Australia 6 years ago, and at the time in Australia, maybe they are now, I don't know, but truck campers weren't so popular. In fact, I'd never even seen one before. That's a noisy bird. Now, truck campers have been really popular in North America for a very long time. In fact, four-wheel campers have been building truck campers since 1972. It took me 12 months of research to finally decide on a four-wheel camper specifically, and we couldn't be happier with the decision. With the four-wheel camper, we are completely off-road capable. We've proven this many, many times over the years, tackling some really tough trails in many, many different locations around the world. Now, the camper itself weighs roughly 397 kilograms dry. A total weight of us with the full tanks, full diesel, full water, with the truck and camper combined, we come in at 3,450. That's 50 kilograms under our GMV for a Defender 130, which is 3,500 kilograms. A lot of people don't believe that, but yes, we are slightly under. To be honest, it's quite rare for a fully loaded overlanding setup. Most people, surprisingly, are over their actual legal limit. With the top down, we are about 2.3 meters. We can fit inside a regular size sea container. This is a huge benefit. We would like to avoid, where we can, roll on, roll off vessels due to the high risk of theft and personal belongings, damage to your vehicle, which is very common with a roll on, roll off. Our other option would be to use a 40 foot high cube container, which is much more expensive. So that is a massive bonus of a four wheel camper on pop top in general. We can even squeeze into some undercover parking areas. It can be a little bit dicey at times, but we have done this in cities where space is limited. The camper itself is very, very spacious. We even have separate living areas. We call them upstairs and downstairs. Now, that's ideal when you live in a tiny house with an annoying bugger like me that wakes up at 4 a.m. every morning. I can head downstairs, sit on the couch, make a cup of coffee, all without disturbing the little Frenchie. We have headroom. That was very important for me. I'm 185 centimeters and I can walk around inside the camper without having to bend my neck at all, so my head doesn't even touch the ceiling. We can also sit up in bed without our heads touching the ceiling. This is quite cool and unique for the four-wheel campers, because they lift on all four corners, whereas some pop tops and converted rooftop cars, they'll pivot on a corner, so even when you're in bed, if you sit up, you're gonna hit your head. That doesn't happen in a four-wheel camper, and that's pretty cool. Since our recent diesel heater install, we are now absolutely comfortable living full-time in this camper through the colder climates. We no longer feel the need to run away from the winter at all. Storage space. We have loads of storage space. Due to the fact that the four-wheel camper had to be raised to clear the cab of the Land Rover Defender 130, this space was utilized in a rear slide-out drawer and side boxes. Heaps of storage space to store our tools, climbing equipment, hiking equipment, spare parts, and camping gear. All right, so now that I've touched on a heap of reasons as to why we went with the setup that we went with, I also want to speak briefly about other options and why we didn't go with them. An option that I want to speak about, which actually would have met our criteria of having the living space and the vehicle as two separate things, was what we did in Australia for 2 years, and that's towing a camping trailer. Now, this was great. In Australia, it's perfect, and probably North America, countries where you've got nice, big, open roads, plenty of space, good condition roads, it's ideal. For an overland journey around the world, I didn't think it was a practical idea. Some of the trails and areas that we've been, I would have hated to have a trailer with me. Some of the tight and windy mountain roads that we have traveled through would have made it extremely difficult with a camping trailer, not to mention the extra costs of shipping, ferries, parking. There's a lot of reasons why we chose not to tow a camping trailer for this particular journey. We could have gone with a rooftop tent on top of the Defender, but firstly, it didn't meet our criteria of having the vehicle and the living space separate. Secondly, we felt that we did our time in a rooftop tent. After 2 years traveling in around Australia, for the long-term journey that we had planned this time, we thought it was a good idea to upgrade with a little bit of extra space and comfort for this journey. The expedition truck, or the big rig. These things are awesome, and it's always been a dream of mine to have a Unimog. That's probably something I would consider other than a Defender. The only thing I would consider other than a Defender, actually. I had a dream of building a Unimog camper. I mean, those things are awesome. I love them, but are they practical for what we wanted to do? We didn't think so. We just could not justify having an expedition truck for our journey. There's just been way too many times where we've been in a situation or on a trail where we just couldn't have done it with an expedition truck or a big rig. There's so many examples, many times, and we bring it up often. We're in a little trail or even a small town or village where we think, if we had an expedition truck, we could not be here right now. There's even been experiences that we would have missed because we couldn't have got to that location if we had an expedition truck. For us, it just wasn't practical, as cool as they are. We could never have done the best overland trail in the world, the Bartang Valley, if we had an expedition truck. Finishing up, I just want to reiterate again that this video was just to give a brief explanation as to why we think that this setup is perfect for us. Our setup is not going to suit everybody, and we completely understand that. And we just hope that this video can maybe throw some ideas out there to help you choose your vehicle, or even to decide what you don't want. Maybe something that we've got is something you don't need. In this video, I didn't go into complete detail of decking out or fitting out the interior of your camper, because I think that, again, is completely specific. So I want to thank you guys for watching. I hope it wasn't too long and boring. And please, any advice and indeed criticisms, feel free to leave a comment. We are always learning. We'll never claim that we've learned it all. It's part of the journey. Once again, thank you so much for checking out this video. Cheers, and catch you later.
Good job. I'm proud of him.
It's all Steffi. She was running around with the camera and helping me out on this one.
Bye.
Bye-bye. Au revoir. Even though there's no subtitles. Sorry, Frenchies.